It's a warm Michigan summer afternoon when a panicked mother bursts through the emergency room doors. Her toddler is cradled in her arms and his little wrist is swollen. He's got all these tears streaked across his face because he fell off the monkey bars earlier that day. And his wrist is clearly fractured, but there's no bone protruding and there aren't any life-threatening signs. Yet here they are, thrown into the chaos of the emergency room. And that room is packed. There are crying kids, there's exhausted parents, there are people like clutching their stomachs, and they're all waiting, and the clock is ticking. I mean, 1 hour goes by, maybe 2 hours, maybe four, and the mom is pacing around the room because she doesn't understand why it's taking so long, and she doesn't understand why nobody's called her son's name. But what she also doesn't know is that across town, or even across the road, there's an urgent care that could have treated him at half the cost. It would have been cheaper, faster, and more efficient. And this isn't just one story. This is a pattern, one that I've seen play out at hospitals across the state hundreds of times. Individuals, many like yourselves, parents, patients, and college students, all coming through the ER doors, not because they don't care, but because they don't know. And so I ask myself the same couple questions over and over again. You know, why are we here? If these aren't emergencies, why are they being brought to the emergency room? And there's another question, one that I'd really like you to think about as we go through this discussion today, and that's, what if the way that we think about healthcare is just completely backwards? For too long, we've placed the burden of fixing the system on overwhelmed emergency departments, overworked providers, and overwhelmed parents. We kind of treat healthcare like a safety net, catching people after they've already fallen, and after they've racked up thousands in avoidable medical bills, and after they've spent hours for something that really could have been handled in just a couple minutes. But what if we flip that approach? You know, what if instead of treatment after the fact, we started with education first? Well, for the past 3 years, my research has uncovered that this is so much more than just a misunderstanding of healthcare resources. It's a crisis of health literacy. And it's hurting our most vulnerable. I mean, families, especially those from minoritized and underprivileged backgrounds, who turn to emergency services not out of negligence, but out of necessity. Because no one has told them what their other options are. And that lack of knowledge, it's costing them. I mean, it's costing us time, money, and valuable hospital resources that really should be reserved for true medical emergencies. But there is good news. This is a problem that we can solve right here, right now. And today, I'm going to show you how, because if we can flip the script on emergency medicine, we can put that power back where it belongs, and that's not necessarily in the hands of doctors and legislators, but rather in the hands of communities and family members and policymakers before they ever step foot into the emergency room. So let's start talking a couple facts. Every year, anywhere from 7.5 to 10.5 million cases of emergency visits related to pediatrics are considered non-emergent. So these are cases that could have and really should have been handled in an urgent care environment, a primary care office, and sometimes even at home. But instead, they flood into the emergency rooms. And in my research, I surveyed data from over 2,000 patient cases in hospital systems across the state. Some of which you might be familiar with. These include Sparrow Health Systems, McLaren Greater Lansing, U of M Health West, and what I found was really staggering. Every single month, there's anywhere from 250 to 300 cases of overutilization. That's about $1,200 out-of-pocket costs for each of those family members, and about $370,000 in wasted healthcare dollars for our communities every single year. On top of that, we have an ongoing staffing crisis in our emergency departments. Every single one of these visits costs us about 1,500 care hours each month. And that's care hours that really should have been invested in true medical emergencies. And these aren't just statistics. This is real-world impact. I mean, overcrowded ERs mean longer wait times for everyone. Imagine being another parent whose child is struggling to breathe, yet they're stuck waiting behind dozens of non-emergent cases for something that really should have been handled in minutes. And that kind of delayed care leads to poor outcomes and avoidable complications, and sometimes even fatal consequences. And then, of course, there's that reimagined financial burden. For many families, a single emergency visit results in crippling medical bills, and these are bills that could have been avoided had they just been guided to the right care in the first place. So again, I ask, you know, why is this happening? If these are not emergencies, why are they being brought to the emergency room? And again, the answer isn't negligence, it's not even bad decision making. It's a crisis of health literacy. And health literacy is so much more than just being able to read a prescription label. It's the ability to understand and navigate and make informed decisions about when and where to seek medical care. And right now, as a community, we are failing at it. So let me give you an example. Will you raise your hand if you or your roommate or your child were to drink an entire gallon of expired milk and then started profusely vomiting over the next 12 hours that you might take them to an ER? Great. That is not an emergency. That is something that should be handled in an urgent care environment. And we asked similar questions to several families in our community. And through that, we saw that 53% of the 523 families, caregivers, and parents that participated in the survey, they were not able to correctly differentiate between a healthcare emergency versus a non-emergency. And even more concerning than that, particularly families from underprivileged and minoritized backgrounds, as I previously discussed, weren't even aware that urgent care was an option. For them, it was the emergency room or nothing. And this isn't just a knowledge gap. This is a systemic failure that stems from families relying on outdated service, mistrust of healthcare providers, and limited primary care availability. Let's be honest, there isn't a lot of weekend and evening availability, and a lot of upfront copays are just not affordable to a lot of our families in our communities. And it's when you put all of these factors together that you get an overwhelmed and overburdened emergency system that just isn't built to handle them. And this is kind of where the latter part of my research comes in. One of the most successful interventions that we had was a simple and intuitive traffic light system. And with this approach, we gave families a simple visual guide for when and where they need to seek care. For example, red stands for emergency departments. So this would be severe breathing difficulties, major traumatic injuries, high fevers in infants. We have yellow or orange for urgent care. So this would be minor fractures, ear infections, and moderate flu symptoms. And finally, we have primary care being green. And that can handle so much more than you would possibly think. And this includes things like colds, minor injuries, and illnesses. And with just this one intervention, we saw a 68% increase in understanding of affordable healthcare options. Finally, these families had a roadmap for healthcare decisions. And for the first time, they felt empowered instead of confused. So what does this tell us? Well, when we educate parents and patients, we don't just reduce the burden on emergency systems, we empower our community to make informed health decisions. But here's the next set of challenges. Education doesn't just exist in a vacuum. We need institutions and policymakers and people just like yourselves to push for that kind of change, and that's where we go next. For those of you who are in the crowd today, if you're a legislator, you have the power to mandate health literacy programs in schools and clinics. If you're a healthcare institution, you can provide proactive patient education into standard discharge protocols. If you're a future healthcare provider or a public health leader, you can demand a curriculum at institutions just like this one that prioritizes patient education. And most importantly, if you're a student or a parent or a caregiver, you have the power to advocate for you and your child. So learn. I mean, ask those questions. Push for the resources that allow you to make informed healthcare decisions. And this solution isn't just theoretical. It's something that's already happening. My research has been presented at hospitals and medical conferences and policy forums, just like many others. It's being integrated into real-world hospital discharge summaries. But the real impact is what's happening right here in this room. And so I ask you, what if we did flip that script? Let's go back to our original scenario. There's a panicked mother. She's panicked. She's overwhelmed. She's pacing through this emergency room. She didn't know she had any other options. She didn't know urgent care would have treated her son faster, cheaper, and more efficiently. But let's rewrite that script. Let's say this time she already knows about that traffic light system that she has hanging on her fridge. She knows about the clear, accessible guidance that she was given at a community health workshop. And she sees her son's injuries, and she assesses the situation, and without concern, without confusion, she takes him straight to the nearest urgent care. She's not just another patient anymore, she's empowered, and that is the power of health literacy. And so I ask you, you know, what if we, as in you and I, or we as in healthcare providers, gave that knowledge back to you? What if we stopped treating healthcare as something that should happen after the fact or something that you have to figure out on your own and instead built a system that supports you before you ever step foot into the emergency room? I think the solution is very clear and the responsibility belongs to all of us. The question is just, what role are you going to play? Thank you.